Hello again, everyone, and welcome back to Learn Linux TV. In this video, what we're going to do is check out the various web browsers that are available for Linux. Many of these are cross-platform and are also available on Windows and macOS. But in this video, Linux is the star of the show, because what I'm going to do is break down the popular web browsers that are available for Linux and let you know the pros and cons of each. Now, the main reason why I decided to create this video is because, well, to be honest, the state of web browsing in Linux is a complete mess. In fact, it's not even all that much better on other operating systems either, because each of these browsers, they, well, have different functions, different features, and sometimes you could sync on one and not the other. Sometimes a browser is available on the Raspberry Pi, other times not. When it comes to Linux especially, there's all kinds of different things that you have to keep track of. So in this video, I'm going to help you choose the best web browser for you. Now, before we go any further though, there is a very special website that I want to make sure you bookmark and read before we get started. I'm not going to go over every single thing on this website, but I do want you to be aware of it. And that website is privacytest.org. It's a very important website that you should certainly visit, especially as you go through this video. This website contains all kinds of information pertaining to how each browser protects your privacy. So as you choose your browser through the rest of this video, you should definitely make sure that you take the information on this site into account. So definitely have this page open as we go through the browsers in this video. But before we get to that, I need to take a moment and mention ThinLink, the sponsor for today's video. ThinLink is a remote desktop solution that enables you to connect to your Linux desktop or server from anywhere. And that makes it great for use at home, your place of work, or, of course, your home lab. If you want to set up a centrally available Linux terminal server, then ThinLink is great for that too. In fact, setting up a remote desktop is a perfect way to test out the browsers that I'm going to be mentioning in this video. You could essentially have a browser open in a remote desktop and then use that same browser instance across all of your machines. The possibilities are limited only to your imagination. Another great use case is to isolate your production environment from the internet. And with all the crazy security stories nowadays, isolation is a great way to deal with that. You could even set up an icon on your desktop that'll launch a remote instance immediately, connecting you to what's important. And best of all, ThinLink isn't just any remote desktop solution. It's a Linux-first product that puts everyone's favorite Tux-powered platform front and center instead of the strictly obligational support that we get from other companies. So check out ThinLink and support Learn Linux TV. I would really appreciate it. As always, thank you guys so much for supporting Linux learning. I really appreciate it. Now, with all of that out of the way, it's time to dive into Linux web browsers. So let's do that right now. First up, Brave. Brave is a browser with built-in privacy controls and ad blocking based on the Chromium engine. Although it's not as popular as some of the other browsers on this list, it does have a very loyal fan base. One of the most unique aspects of Brave is that it gives you the ability to earn rewards by enabling optional ads, and you could use that to support other creators. And Brave features a solid feature set, such as including a firewall, a VPN, and even a built-in ad blocker. Brave features a solid feature set, such as including a firewall and VPN, and even a built-in ad blocker. But unfortunately, Brave has seen a bit of controversy in recent years, stemming from how Brave earns money, and there was also a situation where Brave was caught adding affiliate links to everyone's browser without notice. Now, the company has since apologized, but it makes it hard to recommend a browser with a shaky past. For that reason, it's hard to give Brave a definitive recommendation, but if you aren't bothered by company shenanigans, it might be a great browsing experience for you. Now, if you want to check it out, Brave is available as a distribution package for a handful of distributions, as well as via a Snap and Flatpak version as well, but the vendor currently suggests that you use the distribution package for now. Moving on, let's take a look at Chromium. Chromium is one of the more well-known browsers on this list, and it's the browser that Google Chrome itself is built from. Since Google Chrome is built from Chromium, you can expect the user interface and feature set to be close to the same. Some people opt to use Chromium instead of Google Chrome as a means of getting the Google Chrome experience without as much of the Google. However, even though Chromium is not Google Chrome, it's still heavily influenced by it, so there's always going to be some Google elements that stick around. For that reason, the decision to use Chromium comes down to whether or not you want a completely Google-free experience, or if you don't mind a few Google things here and there. Chromium is available as a distribution package for almost all of the distributions that I've tried recently, including a Snap package on Ubuntu, among other formats. but it's probably best to stick with the distribution package for now. Continuing, let's take a look at GNOME Web. You could basically think of GNOME Web as the Safari of Linux. Just like Safari on macOS, GNOME Web is stripped down and doesn't contain a ton of features, instead focusing on simplicity. Also like Safari, it's generally used primarily to install a browser with more features, as the feature set of GNOME Web lags behind all other browsers on this list. Despite that, the simplicity of GNOME Web has become its main selling point, and people that prefer to browse without distractions might actually adore it. And even though it doesn't have a ton of features, it is able to sync with your Firefox account, so there's that. Perhaps the most significant downside of GNOME Web is that it's not cross-platform. It's available for Linux only. And that's a shame because it's really hard to sell someone on a browser that's not cross-platform nowadays, as browsers like Google Chrome and Firefox are available for nearly everything. So unfortunately, if you do choose to make GNOME Web your primary browser, you're not going to be able to take it with you to other platforms. If you want to check out GNOME Web for yourself, it's available in your distribution's repositories, as well as a Flatpak. However, I recommend that no one use the distribution package of GNOME Web for any reason, as not all distributions do a good job of keeping it up to date. The Flatpak version is an official release that's continually updated, so it's pretty much the only way to go if you want to check out GNOME Web. And you know what? I recommend that you do check it out, because even without all the bells and whistles of other browsers, it's very well integrated into Linux, and its simple feature set lets you browse without the bloat. Sure, it might be laser-focused to Linux, but if Linux is all you use, then that's not a problem. The next browser on my list is one that needs the least introduction of all, Google Chrome. Google Chrome on Linux is the same experience that you'd get on any other operating system, minor platform differences aside. The great thing about this is that if you're in the process of switching to Linux and you already use Chrome, then you can simply sync your Google account to your Linux distribution and utilize the same browsing data. However, the elephant in the room here is that Google is an ad company, and we have to accept the fact that using Google Chrome is using a browser that doesn't act in your self-interest. After all, Google is a company that exists to make money, and they make money from your personal data. And using a browser made by them only makes that process easier. That said, some people aren't really bothered by that and are happy to use Google Chrome. To be fair, although it's a bit memory hungry, it really is a good browser. It's leading the industry for the most part, so it's a browser to beat right now. But when it comes to Linux, though, software and privacy can be very important deciding factors, and anyone that isn't comfortable with their personal information being used will probably want to avoid Google Chrome and maybe even consider Chromium instead as a compromise. Another downside to Google Chrome is a lack of support for the Raspberry Pi, making Chromium the only option on that platform when it comes to the Google browsing experience. If you want to check out Google Chrome, it's available as a distribution package as well as a Flatpak. But as of recording time, the Flatpak version hasn't been verified yet, so it's best to stick with the distro package for now. Next up, Microsoft Edge. Who would have thought that Microsoft would make its successor to Internet Explorer available on Linux, but here we are. And with Edge comes some interesting benefits. For example, you can sign into your Microsoft account and sync data between Windows and Linux, and this might make Linux a bit more approachable for those of you that use Linux desktops on enterprise workstations, because now, if your company mandates Microsoft Edge, you'll be able to be within compliance on your favorite platform. Also, Microsoft Edge uses the Chromium browsing engine, so it maintains compatibility with the majority of websites out there. Now, there is a bit of stigma, unfortunately, against Edge, mainly originating from the fact that Microsoft used to be toxic towards the Linux platform in the past. But the tables have turned nowadays, with software such as Microsoft Edge being made available for Linux, which used to be, well, Windows only. That said, if you have trust issues toward Microsoft as a Linux user, you might have a hard time accepting Edge. However, if you're able to look past that, then you might be in for a pleasant surprise. One downside to keep in mind is that there's currently no Raspberry Pi support, so if cross-platform compatibility with the Pi is important to you, then Edge might not be a good fit, at least not yet. Next up, Firefox. This popular browser by Mozilla is going to be one that most of you within my audience will probably have installed already, as it's the default browser in quite a few Linux distributions out there. And for good reason. It's a very good browser, and it's been an industry favorite for quite some time now. Firefox offers plenty of great features, such as syncing browsing data, extensions, a customizable interface. It's pretty solid overall. And when it comes to being cross-platform, Firefox is about as good as it gets. It's available for just about everything. Windows, macOS, Linux, you name it. And that makes Firefox a great choice if you use more than one platform. As good as Firefox is, though, there are some notable downsides, most notably, Mozilla themselves. Mozilla is a company that prides themselves on protecting your privacy, but every now and then make some business decisions that are questionable at best and violate our freedoms at worst. For example, some time back, there's a tie-in with Mr. Robot, and also, at one point, Pocket was automatically installed on users' browsers without them being asked. More recently, Mozilla purchased an ad company which makes them even harder to fully trust. And this might sound like I'm making a big deal about nothing, but we really do need to trust a company before we trust them with our browsing data, and Mozilla just hasn't always made the most intelligent of decisions. Another issue with Firefox is that its feature set lags behind almost every browser on this list, with GNOME Web being the only one that has fewer features than Firefox does. Now, don't get me wrong, Firefox has a solid feature set, but it only contains basic browsing features and not much else. For example, browsers like Opera and Vivaldi, and even Edge, feature workspaces, but Firefox doesn't. Firefox does feature something called multi-account containers, but its clumsy implementation makes it difficult to use at times, and it doesn't compare to the user experience of workspaces when properly featured in other browsers. And that was just one example. Firefox doesn't see a lot of innovation these days, and other browsers are leaving it behind quite quickly. But even with the more prehistoric nature of Firefox, it's still a solid browser. It's open source, and it offers the same experience on multiple operating systems. However, I wouldn't think that it's a great idea to bank too much on Firefox's future, and it might be a good idea to choose a plan B just in case. Next, let's talk about Opera. Opera is a very interesting browser because its look and feel is quite different from anything else. In fact, I think the UI is absolutely fantastic, and it has the best implementation of workspaces that I've seen in a browser yet. Now, if you're not familiar with the concept of workspaces in web browsers, this concept is very similar to virtual desktops on Linux. With a Linux desktop, you can have multiple workspaces open that each have a separate set of applications open. Now, workspaces in web browsers are kind of like that, except with tabs instead of apps. Each workspace within Opera can be labeled, and when you change from one workspace to another, all your tabs disappear and only the tabs that are specific to that workspace can be seen. You can switch back and forth between these workspaces and even set up your own system for how to label them. But that's not the only thing that Opera does well. I really love this browser. Its performance, everything about it. Well, except for one thing. The thing is, Opera was purchased by a questionable company that may or may not be trustworthy. I'm not going to get into the politics of this, but I will say that you'll have to make a decision as to whether you trust the company that owns this browser, which operates outside of some legal jurisdictions. And that's actually the only reason I don't use it myself. That and the fact that it's not fully open source. Sure, it uses the open source Chromium browsing engine, but it's still a proprietary product at the end of the day, which is why some people might go a different direction despite how good a job the developers did when it comes to designing Opera. I mean, it's just a shame. This browser is really good. Finally, Vivaldi. Vivaldi is a very unique and interesting browser, and it's among my favorites. There is one major flaw with this browser that prevents it from being my full-time browser of choice, but to be fair, it is very well made. Vivaldi is pretty much the king of features when it comes to browsers, having more interesting features than any other browser on this list by far. Tab stacks, workspaces, a built-in email client, newsreader, ad blocking, you name it, and it probably has it, among features you may not have even heard of. Vivaldi is also a fast browser. It's an absolute joy to use. Now we get to the main downside of Vivaldi, and that's the fact that it's not fully open source. For this reason, I can't really recommend it to anyone because most of the browsers on this list are fully open source, which means Vivaldi can't really compete against them. The thing is, Vivaldi does use the open source Chromium browsing engine, so an argument can be made that it is open source, but that's simply not true as some components are closed source and those components could be used as a means of vulnerability chaining attacks, among other problems. Unfortunately, Vivaldi's developers have been very negligent on open sourcing this browser, even going as far as to make claims to justify this that are simply untrue.
Vivaldi.
That said, despite Vivaldi having some great features, I simply can't recommend it to anyone. Until Vivaldi open sources their browser, we should definitely ignore it. I mean, it's really hard to justify a closed source browser when several really good browsers are fully open source. And it's also really silly that Vivaldi's developers claim that they can't make the browser fully open source when other browsers don't seem to have a problem with that at all. However, whenever Vivaldi finally makes the right decision, I'll definitely release an updated video or addendum. Anyway, there you go. I hope you enjoyed my web browser overview. I had a lot of fun producing this video, as I always do. If you enjoyed this video, then please click the like button to let YouTube know that you enjoyed this video. And who knows, if you do that, we might see more Linux on YouTube. That would be awesome. In the meantime, though, thank you so much for watching this video, and I'll see you in the next one.